If you would like to support the channel, then please turn off adblock and refresh the page. Alternatively, use the link in the description below to donate to T1 Patreon. Thank you. Hello, Magic Community on YouTube. I'm T1 Glistener Elf, here with another land destruction deck. I have four that I'm going to be doing in a row. Oh boy, now this one is standard, and it's also mono red. The first... Oh, by the way, before I get started, land destruction in standard. I don't have to tell you anything else. You have to know that we're not going to be playing anything down low like Stone Rain. R&D has been very cautious about making land destruction spells that are actually reasonably playable. And the reason is because they know that LD typically isn't a very fun mechanic. So, if we're going to be playing land destruction, we're going to have to start at CMC4. So, on that note, our first is Demolish. Very simply, destroy a target artifact or land at sorcery speed for 4 mana. Sort of speaks for itself, I'm glad that it got a reprint. Next we have, pretty much strictly better, Structural Distortion, same cost, same speed, exiles it instead, artifact or land, and then it deals 2 damage to that permanent's controller. Very nice, very flavorful. Gives us 8 land destruction spells, but we are not done yet. For the same cost but at instant speed, destroy target land in Volcanic Upheaval. And that rounds out the package. We have 12 now. 12 land destruction spells. These are all very simple ones. Now, for some of the higher curve things we're doing in this deck, some of the more broken things, we have 4 Volcanic Vision. This is such a good card. Return target instant or sorcery card from your graveyard to your hand, often a land destruction spell. Not always, though, but you'll see. It deals damage equal to that card's CMC, so usually 4, to each creature your opponent controls. Wow, well, opponents control, so in more than one-on-one. Now, it does exile itself on resolution, and from an R&D standpoint, it has to, because otherwise you could just loop Volcanic Visions over and over again, and that would be silly. That would be ridiculous. So they had to do it that way. It isn't a real win condition on its own, because it doesn't deal damage to the players. If it did, we would need no other win condition cards in the deck. That sounds so silly. That sounds so good. Yes, Volcanic Vision is an awesome card. Just wipes their board and gets us one of our LD spells back, and once we've done those, usually we can keep the opponent just out of the game for the rest of the game. But what's better than casting one LD or Volcanic Vision? Casting two. We have 3 Pyromancer's Goggles. 3 because it's legendary, it's easy to get too many of these in your hand. Oh, but it's so good if you can get this off. Once you get to the stage in the game where you've cleared the opponent's field, and now you're just casting LD to get them out of the game, Pyromancer's Goggles is silly. One card to destroy 2 lands. Oh, this is so good. And this is really one of the win conditions in the deck. I'll show you why in just a moment, or how, rather. We only have 1 creature in the main board. We have 1 Bedlam Reveler, because the card is too good not to have at least 1. And what I mean by that is, yeah, it's 8 mana, but really it's 2 mana. 2, 3, 4 most of the time. It is a 3-4 with prowess. That's essentially just icing on the cake. When it enters the battlefield, discard your hand, draw 3 cards. Often, when it enters the battlefield at that late stage in the game, you shouldn't have any cards, no more than maybe 1, in your hand at the time. And so this just looks like draw 3 cards on a 3-4 prowess body for down to 2 mana. In a deck like this especially, that's super crucial for keeping you in the game. You're spending all of these resources to keep the opponent out, but when you get into top deck mode, that can be scary. Not with Bedlam Reveler. Now, it's just a one of. If our opponent doesn't see it, or if that's the only one they see, they might take out a lot of their creature removal, and that's going to be good for us going into games 2 and 3. You can probably guess why, but I'll show you in just a minute. Now, these are all fairly high curve. We need to stall the game or ramp into our later spells in order to actually play this deck. So, we have Hedron Crawler for some ramp. Some good old ramp. Easy enough, right? It's our Leaf Gilder in the deck. If you're not playing green, this is what you play in the two drop slot if you just need to make it. This will get us to turn three. Turns Demolish into Stone Rain, turns Structural Distortion into Molten Rain. We're pretty close to them, actually. Next we have four. By the way, I should note here, what we're doing from here on is trying to stall the game, trying to keep the opponent from killing us in time. And that means keeping them off their creatures. So we have four Fiery Impulse. Spell Mastery is easy enough to turn on in this deck that it's pretty consistently three damage later on in the game. Otherwise, it just, you know, works against the humans decks. A lot of the creatures in Coco, you get the idea. Fiery Impulse. There's a reason why you see it in pretty much all the red decks that are running around nowadays. Next we have Incendiary Flow. I'm not crazy about this one, but because it is sorcery speed, but it's 3 damage to a creature or player. Creature or player, that gets to be important in just a moment. And yes, it exiles them if they happen to be killed by it. That matters every now and then. All we care about really is that it's cheap removal and it can hit players. This is our Searing Spear for the deck, but instant speed, but also exile. So, you know, an overcosted Pillar of Flame. But, well, you'll see in a sec, there's Collective Defiance as well. A little bit higher on curve. If you copy it with Pyromancer's Goggles, you keep the modes that you already put into it, so you don't have to pay extra for that. Yeah, there's a Wheel of Fortune on the first mode. There's also 4 damage to target creature, and 3 damage to target opponent as well. Those can be pretty consequential, as you'll see in a second. And then lastly, we have a one-of, I should note all of these are 4-ups. We have a one-of Roast, just to round out our removal package. It's 5 damage, which is great, but it only hits creatures, and even then, only those without flying, so it doesn't hit, say, Avacyn or the dragons. But this is just something to round out that removal package. Now, you may be noticing, with just one creature, how does the deck really win? Well, it would be sick if Volcanic Vision let us hit players, but it doesn't. So what we're doing, ultimately, is we're either swinging with the Bedlam Reveler when the field is clear, that's one way, or we use burn spells. So Structural Distortion, Incendiary Flow, Collective Defiance. All of these are 4-ups, and we copy them with Pyromancer's Goggles to get more out of them. That's really how the deck wins. You stall in the early game, you, in the mid game, just keep killing their lands over and over again, and when you stabilize to the point where you are just destroying land after land, they can't really do anything later in the game, and Pyromancer's Goggles is doubling your lands, well then at that point you can just switch over to, okay, I'm going to deal you 4 damage now with a copied Structural Distortion, 1 and then the copy, I'll deal you 6 damage with Incendiary Flow and its copy, and I'll deal you 6 damage with a copied Collective Defiance. And you just keep doing that over and over again until the opponent has run out of life. There aren't any real life gain decks running around. There's Felidar Sovereign, that's tier 5? I don't know. And then there are some decks with incidental life gain, mostly from Kalidas, Trader of Ghet. But other than that, that should be enough to get you by in most games, and even if you can't win just off the burn plan, if you've kept your opponent off of their creatures well enough, Bedlam Reveler should do the job on its own. Now, that's silly. This is a silly, grindy deck. No fun at all for your opponent. At all. Now for the sideboard. Oh, by the way, 37 spells in the main deck, 23 of them are lands. 23 because we need to fairly consistently hit land, 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 or land, 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 land. And 23 is a good number for that without having too many. However, if you need to take out something like you take out a Roast for another land, perfectly understandable. Next, for the sideboard, we have... there's 3 more Bedlam Revelers. And the reason for that is, okay, they've sided out their creature kill. Let's side in more creatures. Oh, that can be so backbreaking for them. They've just taken out everything that fights the creatures in your deck. Your creatures then go uncontested. Now, if you lost game 1, you do this in game 2 and win, maybe in game 3, yeah, it's certainly possible they'll bring it back in. At that point, you can basically shuffle your sideboard into your main board, take out 15, don't let them know if you're keeping the creatures in or not. If you have the creatures, you basically play a coin toss game, or make them go down the middle. If you bring in your creatures and they
picked incorrectly, you have the creatures to swing in and kill. If they keep their creature kill in and you took your creatures out, well, congrats, that just worked again in your favor. Or they could split down the middle, and regardless of which way you pick, you're going to get some advantage out of that. That's always nice. Next, we have One Boiling Earth. This is specifically for, the tokens decks, although they have enough ways to get outside of that range, and also the humans decks, which again have enough ways to get outside of one damage range. It's not Pyroclasm. I kind of wish it were Pyroclasm, but it's not. So it only hits our opponent's creatures, doesn't really matter in this deck, ultimately. And if they have enough low-to-the-ground creatures, then yes, one damage should be enough to kill, but the humans decks have Always Watching and Thalia's Lieutenant, excuse me, and tokens have Gideon emblems, and Nissa, giving +1/+1 counters all around. So it's not great, but even in those cases, at least it can serve as a later game win condition. Next we have a Crumble to Dust. Because why not more land destruction, even more? There are a few decks we want to remove a land from their deck entirely, Sanctum of Ugin being a prime example in the ramp decks. So this just allows us to do that fairly readily. Or if you can get the opponent off of a color altogether in their deck, well, that also seems pretty sick. Pretty sick. Next we have Galvanic Bombardment. Yeah, I don't have Galvanic Bombardment. I have Shock. In all the packs I've opened of Eldritch Moon, for whatever reason, I haven't opened that one card. No, I don't know why. I just simply haven't. In any case, you should be running four of them. You side them in against low-to-the-ground decks, you know, your humans, your collected company, so on and so forth, where you just need the extra removal, and we side in four because we get such great returns from having multiples. Alright, and next we have four Kozilek's Return. Again, you can see a theme here. We're trying to fight the aggro decks because they're our worst nightmares. We have a good match against control, right, if we can just get out early enough. Mid-range decks, okay. We'll need some answers because they can come out a little bit early. We really worry about the aggro decks. This is our wrath. This is our, you know, we can't run Radiant Flames because we're only one color. Kozilek's Return is as good as we can do in the format right now. It's our Pyroclasm, just a little overcosted. Next we have, to round it out, two Rending Volleys. This is specifically for Archangel Avacyn. This can also be used against some random, some miscellaneous creatures. Shambling Vent is a thing about which we worry, absolutely. You can bring this in against Reflector Mage decks because it will certainly take out Reflector Mage. Not going to be able to counter it, of course, as if that makes that much of a difference. And let me make sure I got the numbers right. Three Bedlam Revelers, a Boiling Earth, a Crumble to Dust, four Galvanic Bombardments, four Kozilek's Returns, and two Rending Volleys, 15 cards in the sideboard. This is your deck, ladies and gentlemen. This is your land destruction deck. Where I would rate this, F&M playable, absolutely. This is 100% F&M playable. PPTQ playable, not in its current incarnation. I won't say that it can't be. It probably can if you tweak it the right way, but even if you do, one of the issues with this deck, unfortunately, is that it is about to rotate. We're going to lose Fiery Impulse, we're going to lose Volcanic Vision, most importantly, perhaps, we're going to lose Pyromancer's Goggles. So don't get too heavily invested in the deck, perhaps, but if you just want to take something like this to your F&M, you'll notice it's a fairly cheap deck. It really is. What's Pyromancer's Goggles is the most expensive card in the deck, and it's a 3 of? And it's probably going down right now as rotation gets nearer and nearer. If you want to invest in something like this, most of the cards in it will survive rotation, and it can be a lot of fun. Trust me, it can be a lot of fun for you. Not so much your opponent, but that's land destruction. That's land destruction in a nutshell, really. Alright, I will see you later. Take care, Magic Community on YouTube. Two more land destruction decks on the way. Oh, so good! And both of them are going to be multicolored decks. One for Standard, one for Modern, so stay tuned for that. I will see you later. Bye-bye.